So, JD showed us some of the lower level stuff he was on. So, I'm going to skip over that. There was a scheduling issue. I didn't know if anything was going to happen, so I prepared some stuff. So, we already learned about servers and clients, but actually, any computer can be a server. Any computer can be a client. These are not so much physical roles as they. These aren't so much like this machine is a server and this machine is a client. These are more like roles in any kind of network transaction. So we talked a little bit about packets already. So you can break things up into lots of pieces. And TCP is the reliable one. TCP is unreliable. So now let's start to talk about protocols. So protocols are little languages that computers use to talk to one another. So we saw a little bit of HTTP, which I'll go more into. There are all kinds of protocols. When you send an email, there's one protocol for sending them. There's another for receiving. There's actually multiple for receiving, which makes it kind of frustrating. There's different kinds of layers that provide encryption, like SSL, which we'll be seeing lots more of that. Why you should absolutely try to use SSL wherever possible. There's also protocols for file transfer, chat, IRC, which we'll be getting into a little bit, and other things. So all of these protocols have a kind of like a customary port that they use. This is a port that clients will just tend to use as a default, so you don't have to remember what port necessarily a service runs on. For HTTP, that's 80, or HTTPS is 443. There's also IRC. A lot of databases have ports, MySQL and CouchDB. There's also SSH. So there's this file on your system, if you're on a Unix system, called etc services. And you can see what all of the different kinds of ports are for all sorts of different systems. A lot of these are kind of outdated, like IRC is listed as 194, but I've never ever connected to an IRC server on port 194. It's always 6667. But there's a lot of fun stuff in here, if you don't mind poking around this arcane text file. So, another thing to note is that by default, I'm using this command NC, which is short for netcat, which I'll talk a little bit more about in a bit. But basically, as a normal user on a Unix system, you can only bind ports greater than or equal to 1024 by default. Anything below 1024, for historical reasons, you need to run as root. So if you try to listen on a port that's like 80, for instance, that'll be why your process will not work, unless you run it as root and ideally drop back down to regular user permissions. So that's kind of a historical thing that used to matter much more than it matters right now. So let's talk about the word server a little bit. So when people say server, they could mean a computer that's like a machine set up to serve, to like pick up the phone whenever somebody contacts them. But actually, a server in another sense just means any program that listens for incoming connections. So this could be a phone, this could be my laptop, this could be any kind of computer. So, and then clients, likewise, you could have a web server that in some ways is a client when it talks to another computer, but in some ways it's a server when other computers connect to it. So it's really more about the role in the TCP connection than this client-server distinction is about what kind of hardware you have, whether it's something on a rack or like whether it's a phone. That part is less important. And then there's all of these other complicated things that make everything much more interesting, peer-to-peer systems. So in peer-to-peer systems, things are sometimes clients and sometimes servers, and that boundary is more fluid. So if you're using something like BitTorrent or now WebRTC in browsers, you're making connections, but it's less important which one actually is listening and which one is receiving, because these things happen in a very fluid nature. So, first thing you should do, because this is all hands-on stuff, is install netcat if you don't already have it. So, if you type nc in your terminal. You could try dash H. If that works, if it prints out some help message, then you have it. You could also try netcat command. So try NC or try netcat, see if you have it. If you don't, you can sudo apt-get install netcat on Linux, probably, or you can brew install something, I don't know.
It's part of the default Mac installation, but it will be NC and not netcat.
Okay, great. If you're on Mac, NC. If you're on Linux, you might have to install it, but just do that really quick, because all of this stuff is really fun to play with, and you can follow along. So what netcat lets you do is you can speak TCP directly. It's just like Telnet, but it's a little bit nicer because it's nicer for some things in that it just reads from standard in and doesn't have any extraneous output, so it's a little bit nicer for what we're going to do. So one nice thing you can do with netcat too, that JD just mentioned, is you can do servers, not just clients. So netcat can speak both sides of the connection. So to make a server, we can just do nc-l for listen, and then p. And frustratingly, sometimes you get the BSD version of netcat, and sometimes you get the GNU version. But if that doesn't work, try it without the p and just the l, for some reason. Okay, so now this program is sitting there. So if I go into another terminal session, now I can connect to our server by doing netcat localhost 7000, and we're connected. So if I type a message on the right, hello, we'll see the message on the left. And likewise, if I type a message from the server, we also see the message from the client. So we've established this back and forth communication. We've basically got a little chat program running. It's really great. But it's a chat program that's just speaking TCP, because that's all that TCP is. It's just a stream of text. You can send, you can receive, you can do everything. So just create a server with LP, and if you kill the server, you kill all of the connections attached to it. So, there's all kinds of things we can do with netcat. So, now that we've got TCP in place, we can start using protocols. These are ways that computers communicate. So, HTTP is one of these. I already mentioned this a little bit in the previous thing. So, HTTP has verbs, like get will fetch a document, post is often used for submitting forms, head can query metadata. So in HTTP, you start with a verb. So you start with something like, you get a request that looks like get slash or like some doc.txt, then you get a version string, then you get headers. These are keys and values. So one of the headers that you're required to have for HTTP 1.1 is like host, which could be like localhost. Might have some other stuff like a content type or a content link, but everything is just a key on the left, followed by a colon, and then some value on the right. So we can make a request. So if you want to make a request to google.com, something like that, then everything after you hit return is kind of like an empty line is the way in HTTP that you tell the request that you're finished. So if I copy and paste this, then I should get, I've already seen this demo, but I'll do it again. So if I copy paste, then I get bad requests because I copy pasted it wrong and there's tabs in there. If I do that correctly though, get slash HTTP 101 post. Hang on, I'll do google.com. I know what it will tell me. It will tell me this thing. It says HTTP, this is the server response, dash 1.1, 301, moved permanent. This is because Google wants me to go to www.google.com, and it's provided this location header in the response. So now, if I send another request, post www.google.com, now Google sends me the homepage. So that's called a status code. So 301 is the status code for redirect, and then browsers or HTTP clients know to sometimes follow those redirects through different documents. So HTTP has a lot of commands. 200 is used for status code that's like, yes, that's okay, here's your document. 300 requests are for if something is at a different location. 400 requests, like 404, is for errors that are the client's fault, like document not found or like bad request, and 500 is for server errors. So there are all of these headers, there's all of this kind of stuff. So one of the things we can do with HTTP, well, first, actually, why don't we just become an HTTP server? So I'll listen on port 8000, like this. Now, in a browser, if I go to localhost 8000, what I get is a GET request, right? So if I want to be a server, all that I have to do is say HTTP 1.1, 200 OK, content type, text, HTML, enter, then I can say some HTML, like, wow. So cool. And then a marquee. Marquees still work, by the way. Such marquee. And in the browser.
Oh.
So we can be an HTTP server. HTTP servers just send text that's formatted according to the HTTP protocol. That's all that they are. That's all that you need to do. So what else can we do? So there's another fun thing you can do with HTTP, that's you can send posts. So posts are like when you have a form. So here's what a post looks like. You have a post with like some URL, it's the endpoint, and you typically send a content link or a content, or you send a chunk to coding, but this is a simple way to do it. So if we send a content link of 51, and now we can send some form values. So this is called a URL encoded form. So the first part is like a title equals, and then there's an ampersand to split the values. And then we have another variable name, which is date, and that equals something else, and an ampersand, and another variable name, body. But you'll notice that we've got percents. So if you've ever seen a URL like %20, %21, this is called URL encoding. And these parameters need to be escaped so they don't clash with other stuff like the ampersand and the equal sign, that sort of thing. So I've got a little HTTP server running here. It's just a simple little node process that will print out what query parameters we send to it. So if we want to make a post request, we can connect to localhost 45000. Post, form, HTTP 1.1, post, localhost. It's common to do content type, I think it's application x www form URL encoded, something nonsensical like that. And then you typically send a content link of like 51, I think, and now we can send. So now we've done a new line, and we can send our message. So if I copy this message that I've already prepared, that's URL encoded, we get back a response from the server. Okay, and what the server saw when it decoded that message was that we had this title, whatever, date was that date, and the body was decoded to be beep, space, boop, with an exclamation mark.
Question. 51 was the number of characters in the post request, right?
Yes. Yeah, 51 is the number of characters.
For that particular string.
Yeah. And there's ways to not have to specify up front what the number of characters is, but you have to use this thing called the chunk decoding, which is actually what we got back from the server when it did 3, which is like in hex for the number of bytes that it wanted to send back. And we got a little message, OK, followed by a new line, 3 bytes, and a 0 to say, OK, I'm done. It's actually in keep alive mode, which means we could send another request, but in this case, I can control C out of the process and end it. So that's a basic thing. Another thing I can do is show you that a localhost 5000, I've got a little HTML form And so when you write HTML with like method equals post and action equals some stuff, you can have inputs with names, and this will be basically the same thing as how we can send that post ourselves. So here it's running, it's just running so learning such wizardry. Very submit. So that's what we get on our server, but we can impersonate the server too by doing nc-lp 5000. Oh, hang on, -lp 5000. So if I submit that form again, now we get this post request from Netcat. So we see post, wow, some headers, and then right at the bottom, so equals learning, ampersand such equals wizardry. Perfect. Mm-hmm. That's what we expected. Great. I'll just kill that, and the browser is like, well, the data. But I could have actually sent those headers, and the browser would have been fine with that. So with all of these kinds of tools, we can make some very cool stuff. So typing all that stuff by hand, though, is kind of annoying. You could use echo, especially echo-e, which will turn escape sequences like backslash n into new lines. With that, you can kind of script some stuff up with Netcat, which is sometimes handy. But another tool that's, if it's not available, you should install it, is called curl. So if you type curl on your system, just see if you have it. If not, do sudo apt-get install curl on Linux, or I think on Mac it comes shipped. Yep. So curl is pretty fun. You can just request web pages and print them to standard out. So curl-s-substack.net gives us my web page. So by default, it just gives the body of the page, which is part of the protocol. But if you do dash capital I, you'll get just the headers.
What if you do it without a flag?
If you do it without a flag, it also just prints out the body, but if you fetch a file that's big, it'll put these stupid progress bars that have no purpose being there in the output. I think the Wi-Fi is being a little bit sketchy, but yeah, so curl is a great way to do these kinds of HTTP requests without having to type in the HTTP headers yourself. And there's a really cool thing you can do with curl. You can use dash capital X to specify an HTTP verb, like post. So if I start the server again, now I can send some. So I'll do curl dash X post. Oh, hang on. Curl dash X post dash D. So now I can say. Such equals wow dash d cool equals beans and do localhost 5000 for this result. And in our server, we see such wow cool beans. Great. So you can, so this is a really handy tool if you need to test a web server that you've made or just want to explore. Curl, HTTP. That's how it works. So this is an example of a text-based protocol. Unfortunately, there are not very many text-based protocols left, increasingly. Well, they're still around. They're still quite popular. The most popular ones are text-based, but many protocols are binary, which means you can't just connect with Netcat. So SMTP is another text-based protocol that's pretty fun. So here I'm running an email server on my local machine. You can connect to any email server, any SMTP server, on port 25. If you do that, oh, hang on, I'm not actually running that, I think I rebooted. XM start. Okay. Let me just actually start that email server. Okay.
This is like summing up everybody's experience with mail servers.
Yeah. What? That's never happened.
Mail servers are like notorious for being incredibly overworked and complicated.
Okay.
And like not working well. I don't know why.
So it started. Now, when I connect to it, it's 25. What is? Okay, it finally got around to telling us this message, which is like, saying hello. So it says this thing that starts with 220. These numbers are very similar to the numbers that HTTP uses, but they're distinct. Numbers that start with 2 are like, great, good job, everything's fine. Other numbers, maybe not so much, although the 301 is also means okay. So first thing you can type when you connect to an email server is hello, or EHLO. So, whoa. So you type hello, and then the name of the host that you're connecting to. This is like the host header from HTTP. So if you say, hello, localhost, we get back, hello. So the server says, yes, I'm that kind of thing that you expect. Now we can send an email. So how SMTP works is it's used to sort of receive emails. So if you send an email to somebody else, their server is running a program like this. And your email server talks to their email server over this protocol that we're using right now. So send hello. Now we can specify the recipient of the email. Or we can say who we are. The server has no way of verifying any of this, so we can make up whatever we want, like Barack@whitehouse.gov. Okay, so the server is fine with that, apparently. Now we can say who the recipient is, so you do rpc2, substack@localhost, accept it. Now we can start typing our message. So if I say data, now the server is listening for us to print the body of the message. And when we're done, we should type a period on its own line. So the first part, so email actually uses the same kind of headers that HTTP uses. So it's like key, colon, and then value. So if we do subjects, important message from the president, followed by an empty line, and now we can say, this is Barack Obama, President of USA, you need your help. Reply immediately. Barack. So if we have a message like this, now we do a dot on its own line, and that sent our message. So if I type quit now, I'll terminate the connection, and I should have some mail. There we go. So now I'm reading the email, Barack@whitehouse.gov. So if I type N, we get our message. This is Barack Obama, President of the USA. We need your help. Great. So that was our message from the president. Yeah, and we actually get the subject. I'm just kind of zoomed in a little bit much. But so that's how email works. There's no verification anywhere. You can just connect with Netcat and send as many completely wacky messages as you like. It's really fun. So what are some other protocols we can have some fun with? So one of them is this old chat protocol called the IRC. So we've actually got a channel on this network called Freenode, called CyberWizard. So here I'm logged in to a server on the left, but I could just connect with Netcat too. So if I do Netcat, hang on. If I do Netcat, irc.freenode.net, 6667, which is the standard IRC port. But I believe my network is a bit sketching out, so let me just reconnect really fast. So you'll notice that I'm using another protocol, SSH, to log into my web server, actually. And on that server, I've got an IRC client that's always online. It doesn't work very well if you're not connected. So let's just connect to Freenode directly if the network cooperates. Well, so we're connected to FreeNode. We get some messages. I have to type quickly because it will time me out. So the first thing you do is type Nick. So I'll say Nick, whatevs, and now user, whatevs, colon, and then some other message. Once you've done all of that, so FreeNode is doing a lookup for your hostname right now. You just give it a sec. Can't tell though, because the network is actually being kind of uncooperative, unfortunately. Okay, cool. So, it's really slow. Oh, connection timed out. Okay. So, do Nick, user, this. Okay. What? What? Hang on. Let me. Oh, you have to do the host name as the. Oh, this is completely stupid, but you have to do all of those with like. Okay. Okay, cool. So now I can actually start doing some real stuff. So if I do join and then a hash cyber wizard, you'll see on the left I should be able to join. There we go. So whatevs has joined the channel cyber wizard in my real client here. So if I say, if I do PRIV MSG private message pound cyber wizard colon hello world, you'll see in IRC now this user whatevs, which is me in Netcat, is the message hello world, and I can say more messages. I can say cyber wizard colon hack the planet. You'll see more stuff. So if you want to quit, just type quit, and now whatevs has disconnected. So yeah.
Who else is logged in right now?
Logged into IRC.
Well, this looks like, you know, there's an ultra lame and a Karen punk, and I just thought they were in the room. So.
Yeah, I think other people are following along, which is great. So, here is basically what we did. So I typed Nick, and then some made-up name, and then user with some other made-up names. These don't have to be the same. It'll work pretty much no matter what you do.
What are they? What are they representing?
It's just some, kind of some legacy stuff from the IRC protocol. It used to map to like your username on the Unix system by default, and like they're basically just baggage at this point. Like Nick is the one that actually matters.
Yeah, that's what you show up
as. Yeah, and then you can do join the channel name, and then you can message the channel. And as other people were in the channel saying things to us, their messages appeared. This one, private message cyber wizard colon. And someone else said that. Karen Punk said that. Cool. And people are saying cool stuff right now, too. So, that's IRC. That's the commands. These are some examples of text protocols. So, HTTP, SMTP, IRC, these are all just text, and you can just type it with your fingers to talk to another computer. We're really used to interacting with programs like web browsers and IRC clients and email clients and that kind of stuff, but fundamentally, a lot of these protocols are just simple text behind the scenes. So there's also these things called binary protocols. That just means stuff that would be really hard to type out yourself. They're just kind of, it's just like some weird hex representation of everything, and the binary protocols are often used to save space over the wire because it does take more data, usually, to transmit things in plain text. But you can do things like compression to help minimize that. One example of a binary protocol is SSH. This is a protocol that you can use to securely connect to other servers, and we'll see more about what securely means and doesn't mean in a moment. But the protocol is mostly binary, except for the first line that sort of tells you that, hey, this is an SSH. If you try to do anything else, it'll tell you to go away. So let's inspect some protocols. So there's this great command called tcpdump in Linux. I don't know Wireshark. It does the same things, but it's a little more graphical.
On Mac.
Yeah. Oh, cool. So apparently it TCP dump, you can use it on Mac. So let's inspect a protocol. So I'm on the Wi-Fi right now. So is everyone else. The Wi-Fi is unencrypted. Wi-Fi works like Ethernet, meaning that when you transmit something to another website over Wi-Fi, you're sending things with a little radio beacon in your computer. That radio beacon is being received by every other computer in the network. So if we do sudo tcp dump dash a, and we just run that for a second, there's usually more traffic. There we go. We can see some traffic. If I let that scroll past a little bit, you can see, like, okay, that's like some, this is probably someone logged into EC2 over SSH. Waiting a sec for somebody to visit a web page. I'll just visit a web page so that we can see it in the output. So, HTTPS, HTTPS. So you can also do some stuff if you just want to listen to a particular type of traffic. You can set, you can specify some flags, TCP dump, kind of hard to read down there. If I do sudo TCP dump TCP port 80, this will only show stuff on port 80, which is unencrypted HTTP, or unencrypted web traffic. So, right, so we see some headers, user agent, refer, so that's like a web page, and we can completely read the content because it's all being sent in the clear, unencrypted. If I visit a web page, we'll see that in the TCP dump output. Whoa. So, if I scroll down a bit, you'll see some HTML. There we go. So, that's something in some web page. What's really fun is this stuff is just text, which is good and bad, right? Because this means that anyone can see your traffic, but it's also just something that you can inspect. So if you want to actually figure out how a protocol works, TCP dump and Wireshark are really good ways of going into the bytes that are being sent over the wire and figuring things out. So like here's some output that I was capturing last night. It's a bit large, unfortunately. So please respect people's privacy when you're doing this, because like the web just works this way. But also, this should be kind of a warning that anyone can be running this command at any time, and not just locally, like not just in a cafe, but also further upstream. Like when you send unencrypted traffic over the network, anyone can read it, pretty much, like has the capability to be in that pipeline. So, there we go. So you can inspect other traffic, like if we want to see what happens when connect to IRC, we could do like TCP port 6667, and now if I connect to freenode.net with like username, oh, I'm already seeing traffic from other people's IRC sessions, apparently. So you can scroll up and like see what's going on with an IRC session if you want. Yep. So there are all of these protocols. They're really fun. Here's some links to the, they're called RFCs. These are the technical specifications for how these kinds of protocols work. There's one for email, IRC, HTTP. Pretty much every protocol that we use commonly has an open specification that you can read to see all that it does. So, thanks. Wow. So, if any questions, you can just pop up your hand or just talk to me a bit quickly.
Is there going to be any discussion of encryption, like a lecture on encryption?
Encryption. We could.
I think there's going to be at least the cybersecurity slash hack. Sunday.
Was there a crypto party?
Crypto party and a Cyber Wizard workshop.
Okay, cool. So it looks like there'll be